Hi everyone, welcome to this episode of the Connect series. My name's Nick Smith. As you can see, we're missing Adrian today, but don't worry, we'll push on. And we have Evan Wakefield here to help drive the conversation. He's the applications manager of our automotive connectivity team, and he's gonna talk about battery management systems today. Thanks for joining, Evan.
Yeah, no, it's great to be here again.
Yeah, I forget you're a repeat offender, so we appreciate you coming back. So first question for me, I really don't know much at all about battery management in vehicles, wired or wireless. Can you just give me a high-level overview of that?
Of course. So today there's a big trend pushing towards hybrid electric and electric vehicles in automotive. And with that means that there's an evolving trend of seeing how we can make batteries more efficient. How can we build cars that make sense as far as production, as far as cost to maintain? In those hybrid electric and electric type domains. And one of those pushes is inside of battery systems today, there's a lot of cabling. It can be costly and sometimes it can fail. And in order to actually maintain a battery, if a battery is maybe broken, it takes a lot of effort to replace an individual cell inside of that system. Typically, to the point where it's just worth it to trash the entire battery pack itself and replace it with a new pack. And so a lot of OEMs and tier ones are trying to dig into how can we make this a little bit more cost effective to build and perform maintenance on these battery systems. And that's kind of the trend that we see today. And a lot of the people are aligning on an answer that they want to go wireless because it'll free them up from the constraints of being in a wired system that has complicated, you know, wiring schematics and whatnot, and they can just plug and play cells that have a wireless device on top of it.
Okay. Yeah, and to go back to something you said to make sure I caught it right, you said there's several miles of cabling inside.
Yeah. Yeah, so it depends on the size of the battery, the number of cells inside of the battery, but there can be a significant significant amount of wiring inside of each of these battery packs. And you can see that translate into weight, which means that your car is heavier, which leads to efficiency. It makes your car less efficient. And so if you can replace that with something wireless, you obviously save a ton of weight, and you can actually make your cars a little bit more efficient while also making them easier to produce and easier to maintain.
Okay, yeah, interesting, yeah. I'm still trying to wrap my head around that length of cabling being inside the battery, but so I guess, you know, moving to a wireless management system, mm-hmm. what are some of the key factors or design challenges to address that are meeting the same spec, I guess, as a wired system today?
Yeah, absolutely. So a lot of the requirements are pretty similar. A lot of people want to see a very low latency, high throughput, low power type wireless protocol. And one of the biggest things that people are looking for is how can we make this scalable so that we can go beyond maybe 8 cells into a range of 32 cells or even more than that? And how can we make sure that the network formation, so when I turn on the car, that the network actually forms in a particular amount of time? Oftentimes we hear a requirement that's like 300, 400 millisecond requirement for turning the car on for the batteries to all join the network and start reporting information. And so those are really kind of the main concepts that we're targeting with our wireless BMS protocol that we're developing here at TI. And then one of the big things that people want is reliability. So packet error rate is one of the top things that customers ask about today. We're in a pretty challenging environment. You're in an enclosure of some sort. So when you throw a bunch of wireless devices inside that enclosure, there's lots of multipath, there's lots of different propagations that can happen. So how can you demonstrate that you have a reliable wireless connection that meets the requirements that are set before us for what is effectively a tough environment?
Okay. Yeah, it makes sense. And to go back to one of the things you said low power is important.
Mm-hmm.
That's surprising to me because, you know, I'm used to our technologies working on coin cells and stuff like that, but you have a big old car battery. Can you explain why low power is an important consideration?
So there's really two kind of key aspects that customers are looking for when it comes to low power. And the first one is in the key off scenario. And in a lot of systems that cars have today, even if they're a hybrid electric and electric vehicle, they still have systems on that car in the key off scenario where they're running off of a 12 volt lead acid battery. And you don't want to overutilize that battery because there's scenarios where you want to make sure that your car starts after extended periods of time being off. The second scenario is making sure that you've got all this energy stored in this battery. You want to make sure that you use that energy appropriately and not abuse that energy to where you're affecting the range or the efficiency of your car from a drivability point of view.
Okay, yeah, makes sense. So in one case, when the when you're in the key off, you don't want to be draining that battery to where I get back from my trip, go to the airport parking lot, my car won't start because the battery's dead.
Exactly.
And on the second case, you want to be using, sounds like you want to be using the battery, the power budget there for what it's intended for, not the overhead of a protocol.
Much more well put.
Okay, that makes total sense. And then one last question, then I'll stop bombarding you and we'll get to the demo, which I'm sure people want to see. You've touched on it already a little bit, but can you summarize kind of the benefits of going wireless here?
Yeah, so the benefits of going wireless is there's a lot of benefits as far as building the battery up. It can be a little bit cheaper. We've seen OEMs discuss some of those benefits and not going to get into the details, but then maintenance is certainly one of the biggest ones. Weight savings, so leading into the efficiency of how you utilize your power and the weight of your car.
And that one I wouldn't have believed was a big factor until you told me how much cabling is actually in the car.
It's
impressive.
So. Absolutely. And I'd say that pretty much summarizes kind of the benefits that you have out there today when you talk about a wireless battery management system.
Okay, yeah, thanks. No, that makes total sense. I can totally see the draw to go wireless. And now, as promised, let's get into the demo. We've been looking at this the whole time. I'm interested to hear, can you tell us what we're looking at? What's going on here?
Yeah, so this is the demo. It's been running for the entire time that we've had this conversation. And here we have 8 different slave nodes kind of communicating with this master node right here. And that corresponds to each slot on this GUI. So node 1 corresponds with this node right here. Node 2 corresponds with this node right here. And then we have the master node in the center of the GUI. And the master node is actually reporting its transmit and receive throughput. And so here we have a transmit throughput of 106 kilobits per second and a receive throughput of 847 kilobits per second, which kind of shows the throughput capabilities of this protocol and gives you the flexibility of being able to scale to higher numbers of nodes, aka supporting more cells inside of your wireless BMS system.
Right.
The other node the other kind of parameters that we want to point out here is the latency. So each node is scheduled in a particular slot in time. So node 1 is at 1.97 milliseconds, node 2 is at 3.62 milliseconds, and so on and so forth as we go across the number of nodes. The next number that we have here is the packet error rate. So this is the packet error rate on the first transmission. Meaning that if something is missed on the first transmission, there will actually be a retry later on after the last node in the system has done its first try. So there'll be a kind of a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And if one missed, it will be rescheduled at after 8.
Okay.
And it does that at 100 millisecond interval right now as it's programmed.
Okay.
In this case, the packet error rate on nodes 2 and 3 is real low, and that's very, very good. A lot of OEMs and Tier 1s are targeting having what we would call 5 or 6 nines of reliability, so reliability of 99.999% transmission success on the first try.
Wow.
And then over the time that we've been sitting here, we have transmitted roughly 164,000 packets. And so that shows kind of the reliability over time. And we're in a relatively noisy environment with Wi-Fi devices, Bluetooth devices, our phones are transmitting. There's a lot of 2.4 gigahertz noise in this area. And the devices are performing pretty reliably.
Okay. Yeah, I'm sure the TI lab has a pretty high noise floor. So that's great. I really appreciate you walking through this demo with us. Appreciate you guys tuning in. This is a very cool technology. You're going to see this going into vehicles. And this is certainly not the last video you're going to see us covering this. Evan and his team are leading the charge here and developing really, really exciting technology. So Evan, really appreciate you being here. Thank you. Thank you guys for joining as always. Don't forget, next week we're going to have another great video, another great demo, another expert here. Be sure to tune in. We have a lot of exciting stuff coming from the connectivity platform. Thanks, guys.
See y'all.